So we want to, of course, welcome you to the Missouri History Museum. My name is Cecily Hunter. I'm the public historian for the African American History Initiative, and I'm so honored and grateful that you all are here with us today. Joining us for our Tuesday daytime program, which is called Black Resistance, Extraordinary Black Missourians. MHS Black History Month program is presented by Wells Fargo. At the museum, we offer most of our programs to you all for free, and this is in large part thanks to our members. If you are an MHS member, we're greatly appreciative of your support. And if you're not, we hope that you would consider becoming one today. When you arrived, you received evaluations for the program, and this essentially really helps us as we plan future programming. So if you would be so gracious as to fill out that card for us and then turn it into the hands of an MHS staff at the conclusion of the program. Again, we're truly grateful for you for that. The Association for the Study of African American Life and History's national theme for this year is Black Resistance. We are here today with Dr. John A. Wright Jr. for a deep dive into the history of Black resistance in Missouri and St. Louis, highlighting historical figures from the book Extraordinary Black Missourians. Dr. Wright Jr. is native of St. Louis, and he is a retired Pettus Award-winning elementary school teacher in the St. Louis public school system. He has an Associate of Arts degree from St. Louis Community College, a Bachelor of Arts degree from the University of Missouri, St. Louis with a history minor, a Master's degree of Education from the University of Phoenix, and a Doctorate of Education degree from Maryville University. So lots of amazing accolades right there, right? He has also tutored in higher education and taught as an instructor of adult basic education. Dr. Wright has co-authored books on local St. Louis history and has given numerous city tours featuring St. Louis's Black historic sites. During today's program, we are so honored for him to be here. He will focus on Moses Dickson, Robert Hickman, Frankie Muse Freeman, Percy Green, and so many more. This program will be followed by a book signing, so we do hope that you will join us following this program today in the museum's shop. So please join me in welcoming Dr. John Wright Jr.
Thank you all so very much for coming. I appreciate you taking the time in the middle of a day. It's not often that I get a chance to speak during the day, so I'm glad to see so many people who are able to come out and help me with this. There's a lot of wonderful stories that we have to tell, and not everybody is aware, so we find ourselves fighting for inclusion. And to give you an example, my day started off with my wife screaming at the TV. When your wife's up screaming, it's not necessarily a good thing. And it just so happened that Channel 4 was talking about a pharmacy that opened up, and they were talking about St. Louis's first Black pharmacy. And my wife was livid, in particular because her father was a pharmacist who had his own pharmacy, who's no longer with us. It just highlighted the fact that we need to be able to be aware of our own stories, and we need to be able to tell our own stories. We need to be able to make sure that we're getting it right, or at least be aware enough to know that when someone else is telling our stories, that they are getting it right. So today, we are going to be talking about a few figures. The book has far many than I can cover in the time I'm given. However, I'm going to do the best I can in the time that I have. And if there are any additional questions, please ask. Or if there's something that you think I missed or didn't get, let me know. Just kind of pull me aside or call me out, and we'll address it. When we're talking about Black resistance doesn't necessarily happen in the form of being able to a physical revolt of sorts. James Beckwith was resisting by taking himself out of the equation. He didn't refuse. He refused to accept the narrative that he was given. He began as a blacksmith, but saw himself as being so much more than that. So he left. He left St. Louis, and he lived amongst the Indians. There was a woman who saw him and believed, an Indian woman, who believed that she was his long-lost child, her long-lost child, and he was adopted into the tribe. And from there, he led he functioned as a group of, and then he decided to work with the United States government and settlers to find a pass through the Sierras. Now, what's interesting about that pass that's still named after him is that there was a film that was done years later where they changed the name of James Beckwith. Instead of calling him James, they called him Saul. And in the film, he no longer is a black explorer, but they made him white. So when we're talking about being aware of our history, this is an instance where we're having other people who are rewriting our history and then changing the narrative. James was eventually, had become a chief in the Sioux Nation, and he angered others, and he was poisoned while living amongst the Indians. York was somebody that we're learning more and more about with each year. He was on the Lewis and Clark expedition. There is a statue of him, that picture that you see is from a picture of him, where he is featured in the Drury Inn. There's a statue of the Lewis and Clark expedition on the river that does not include York. Now, York was a slave, and he was treated as an equal on the expedition. He was found to be an integral part of the addition. He no longer functioned as if he was a slave. He was found to be invaluable with working with the native tribes as they were traveling. And he relished in the part of being an equal, of not having the burden of being a slave, but being treated as a free man, which made it very difficult for York when he returned to St. Louis when the expedition was over, because he was expected to turn back into a slave and assume that role, which he did not do willingly. In fact, Clark had beaten him severely, often to try to get him to assume the role that he once had. The only reason that he really came back was just because he wanted to come back as a free man and be married to live with his wife. And Clark was not going to allow that. And he paid the price for it. It was said that Clark finally relented and was going to allow him to have his freedom, but he died coming from Kentucky back to St. Louis to fulfill that promise. Robert Hickman was a minister. He was allowed to read and write, enabled to him to pass the gospel, preach the gospel. The gospel was seen as a means of helping to control slaves, and that you would be fed passages about being good to your masters. obeying your master. And he was allowed to become a preacher and preach in the mid-Missouri area around Boone County. For those of you who are Mizzou grads are familiar with Boone County in that area. And while in that role, it enabled him to gain the trust of other slaves, and he used that that ability to pass between plantations to arrange for an escape. Now, he took those slaves that were with him, and they rafted down the Missouri River. In fact, around Jeff City, that looked like they were going to be caught. They abandoned the rafts, or abandoned being on top of the rafts, and at night sank into the water and were rescued by a sympathetic barge captain. They were then floated into St. Louis and traveled up the Mississippi, where they formed their own Christian colony in Minnesota. The first order of business when they got there wasn't to find a job, but was to establish a place where they could worship. John Baptiste Sebel was the founder of the city of Chicago, but he was based for a good part of his life and out of St. Charles. In fact, he's buried in St. Charles, Missouri. He came back after leaving Chicago because he was very, very religious. And he had gotten married, but he wanted his marriage to be sanctioned by the church. It was very important to him that he had the church's blessing, and they enjoyed the sacrament of marriage as a practicing Catholic. So he came back to St. Louis with that in mind. It goes to the depth of wanting to acknowledge and accept his role and being a part of society that would be looked upon in a way that he thought would be religious or pious. Dred Scott's case is familiar with a number of people. A number of people might know why Dred Scott had gone to court. Dred Scott had a master who was in the army, and he took Dred Scott with him to free states as a valet. This was not unusual for a number of soldiers to do who were wealthier or well off. They would do this, and they would, because they deemed people as property, just as they would take their own horse, they would take their own servants. Now, Dred Scott, for the most part, was living in St. Louis with his wife, Harriet, and they were pretty much left alone on their own. They were still considered the property of a family, but they did not necessarily own up to or were accountable. They were sort of allowed to live off on their own and keep what little that they did have until someone realizes that, Dred's owner realizes that they need to pass Dred and Harriet on. It was deemed that because they were property, they would be given to other family members. And at this time, the freedom suits were taking place in St. Louis. I don't know if you're familiar with the freedom suits or not. There is a monument to the lawyers and those who were part of the freedom suits that's downtown now in front of the civil courts, or the front or the back of the civil courts building, depending on your point of view. The freedom suits were where people would go to court and make a case for their freedom. Dred's case stated that once his owners took him and Harriet to free states, as well as both their daughters were born in free territory, that they should remain free. Now, this was should not have and would have normally been an open and shut case, as many of the other suits were, but this wasn't. It went all the way to the Supreme Court, where the Judge Tully, the Chief Justice, had stated that Dred and Harriet had no business going to court because they weren't even human beings. People that weren't people, or people that weren't human, had no business in court, and said that Dred and Harriet, or for that matter, any black person, was only entitled to the rights that white people allowed them to have. And he, in essence, nullified the Missouri Compromise. So in that instance, instead of there being slave states and free states, if slave masters could take their slaves to free states, then there was no such thing as free states anymore. And it set the stage for the Civil War. There is a monument to Dred and Harriet that is on the eastern part of the old courthouse, which stands. It's a relatively new monument, considering the old courthouse is it's getting close to 200 years old. It's also very close, ironically, to the eastern steps where slaves were auctioned up through till 1861. Elizabeth Keckley was best known for being the dressmaker for Mary Todd Lincoln. But before she became a dressmaker for the First Lady, she helped a number of women who were coming out of slavery by giving them a trade. It was her job to work with helping women become seamstresses and to try to teach them a rudimentary education, basic reading and writing, so that they could become independent after forced servitude. She was very active in the church, and she continued to teach reading and writing. In fact, one of the things that she did was that she wrote a memoir about her time with the Lincolns that she thought she could use to kind of help Mary Todd Lincoln in her cause after her husband's assassination. But the family didn't see it that way. They looked at it more as a tell-all and a betrayal. And she never quite healed the rift that was created and what she thought was doing a good deed. But it just wasn't taken that way. Many kids my daughter's age were very familiar with a Disney character called Mulan. Mulan is about a Chinese woman who dresses up as a man and joins the army to fight in her father's place. Well, we didn't quite have that same situation, but there was a woman named Cathay Williams. Cathay Williams became William Cathy. Cathay Williams, during the Civil War, her family moved to Jeff City, where the soldiers freed her. And she, the Union soldiers, and then she began working for the Union Army. When the war was over, all of a sudden she finds herself needing work and can't find it. So she cuts her hair and changes her dress and enlists in the army as William Cathy. And goes off along with the soldiers into the Indian territories of New Mexico and Arizona. And she exists as a man. There were no physicals then, nobody to check, no way means of knowing. And she drew a pay, wore the uniform, showed up to work every day. And then after a while, she gets tired of Army life and wants to leave. Not being able to just up and leave, they try to see what's wrong with her because she says she is sick. They do a physical and discover she's a woman. Not knowing what else to do, she is immediately discharged. But she's falling on hard times, and then because she served during the war and after, she looks for a pension. She wants a soldier's pension. But it was denied to her, and she dies looking for that money that she thought she was rightfully owed. It's a fascinating story. Many people have seen the HBO film, The Tuskegee Airmen. And others have seen the film Red Tails done by George Lucas somewhat later. I really prefer the HBO movie over the George Lucas production, but they both contain a scene where there is a man who takes Eleanor Roosevelt up in an airplane. That person really did exist in real life. He was not one of the fighters that was merged into the stories that you'll find in those productions, but his name was Charles Anderson. Charles Anderson is fascinating. He lived in the University City area on a farm, but he, in addition to earning a doctorate at MIT, was a self-trained pilot. He used his savings, bought a plane. He was the first African-American to receive a pilot's license, an American pilot's license. Now, I know a lot of people will tell me about, in particular, like Bessie Coleman, who got her pilot's license in France, but it was an international pilot's license. He used a map, a road map, since that's all he had, to be able to fly from one end of the country to the other. He flew from the East Coast to Los Angeles. He flew from Florida to the Bahamas. He did a number of things that were very unique for him at that time. And when people were waiting to be able to fly out in the Army Air Corps and were held up, he was the one who flew Eleanor Roosevelt and thus ending the Tuskegee experiment and paving the way for black pilots to join the fight. A number of people know about Annie Malone because of the parade, but they don't really know exactly what she did, other than being a philanthropist who gave money to a children's home. But Annie Malone was so far ahead of her time. The things that Annie Malone put in place still exist today in the form of Amway, Mary Kay. A number of those practices exist that were very new. She had hair products that she knew would sell, but she needed help selling them. So she creates a marketing system where women could become their own business people. For a very small investment, she would give women the opportunity to wholesale a product that they could then retail. That she taught them how to use it, how to help women with their hair. So basically, that's what she built an empire off of, women and hair. It was, became so big that it's now apartment buildings now, but on St. Ferdinand and, thank you, Kennerly. There used to be Poro College, and it's turned down. It's now apartments for the Jackson, forgive me. My brain's a little scrambled at the moment, but it gave people an opportunity. It had a movie theater. It had a banquet hall. It had classrooms. It also was the headquarters to one of the first black women millionaires in this country. And one of her students is better known as Madam C.J. Walker, who went on to, who worked for Annie and was a little better at marketing and clever enough, as they rumor, to have gone to a chemist to slightly alter, I guess we would now refer to it as like a generic, her formulas to get the same results. And I'm told that they never did quite make up, even though I'm told that C.J. Walker tried. And said, look, you know, we're both millionaires, we've both made it, can we heal the rift? But Annie wasn't so quick to let it go. Annie suffered terribly during World War II with product shortages because of the war and a horrible divorce, and watched her empire slowly fall apart. She left St. Louis and moved on to Chicago, where she died. But while she was here, her legacy of philanthropy still exists in the form of the children's home that was then named in her honor and the parade that that's the first Sunday in May, second Sunday in May in St. Louis every year. Herman Dreer is a marvel to me. He was so smart and so lettered and so underappreciated in his time. You have this brilliant man who comes out of college, Phi Beta Kappa, and has nowhere to go. No one will accept him. And so he goes to the one place where he can pour in his knowledge. He teaches Latin, Greek, chemistry, biology at Sumner High School, the first black high school west of the Mississippi. And he pours all of that knowledge into those students as he tries to further his education while here in St. Louis. He is denied entrance into both Washington University and St. Louis University because he is black. Knowing that there are other students that are in a bind, such as the students that he teaches in high school at Sumner, he reopens a Douglas University, a school that he can have some sort of control and influence over that would offer students that were leaving Sumner a chance at higher education. He goes back to Sumner and ends his career there. In the meantime, he becomes a researcher, an aide with a woman named Margaret Bush Wilson in the fight to end segregated housing in St. Louis. So he helps a man named George L. Vaughan. Some of you might remember the name from the Vaughan Housing Projects. It's named after George L. Vaughan. George goes to the Supreme Court and they end segregated housing because it's the restrictive covenants, because they're in violation of the 14th Amendment. Most everybody that went to anybody's elementary school knows about George Washington Carver and the peanut. Although the peanut had very little to do, or had, it had some to do with what he had developed, but he was so much more than the peanut and those projects. But in a, the end result of his research and his work was to change the way people did farming. It changed the South, and that it, while people were struggling to deal with soil that had been used up, it taught people about crop rotation. It revolutionized the South in a lot of ways, and because he asked for no money for any of his research or any of the things that he did, he got a number of people, including one of his biggest benefactors was Henry Ford, who poured money into George Washington Carver's research and into Tuskegee Institute. A number of people might recognize the statue if you're down in Keener Plaza or across from the old courthouse. It's a relatively new statue of Frankie Freeman. Frankie Freeman, some of you might have even known, she didn't die that long ago. She was, I know the women of Delta Sigma Theta are very pleased because she was a once president of the organization, one of their more famous members. But when Pruitt-Igoe was built, Pruitt was to be for black residents, named after the pilot Wendell Pruitt, and Igoe was a legislator that was supposed to be where white residents would be held. And she argued that it should be for everybody. In fact, one of the places where she did the arguments and the talks was at the Chase Park Plaza. I've had the pleasure of knowing her granddaughter, who was telling me about her grandmother, Frankie Freeman, the attorney Frankie Freeman, going to meet with President Eisenhower, not Eisenhower, but Johnson. And she was successful in ending housing discrimination in public housing. Lloyd Gaines is really interesting in that it's one of those unsolved mysteries. Lloyd Gaines argues that he wants to become a lawyer, and there's a law school, and that he should be able to join the University of Missouri. He should be able to be a student there. So he qualified to be there, but they wouldn't accept him because he was black, so he takes it to the Supreme Court and challenges the Plessy versus Ferguson ruling, saying that there's no place else to go, so that they have to accept me. So rather than accept him, the University of Missouri maintains its segregation but creates another law school through its other state school, Lincoln University. And Lincoln University becomes one of the premier law schools for blacks until integration. The interesting thing about it is after he wins the case, he gets on a streetcar and is never seen again. No one knows what happened to him. No one knows where he was. There are people that remember seeing him board the streetcar. His family didn't know. He literally disappears. A number of people remember Percy Green for his work, but most famously for chaining himself to the arch. He had argued that there were a number of people who were making, there were several people making money off the project, and none of them were black. In particular, what made that even more painful was that the land that they were using to build the monument on was from where black people were displaced. So he did get the attention, and there were people that were given contracts to work because of Percy Green's actions and bringing it to national attention. Henry Armstrong was a fighter. He was one of those people who, unsung, despite winning titles in three divisions simultaneously. But he very quietly influenced the youth around him by working at the Herbert Hoover Boys Club, where he was a former director. I'm trying to be mindful of people's time. I'm looking at the clock and I'm realizing that I've got to step it up. So if I'm missing or leaving something out, please let me know, because I'm looking, it's like, oh, I've got like more slides, more stuff. Scott Joplin. The Scott Joplin House, many people still recognize because of the signs in front on Del Mar. Scott Joplin chose to live in that particular neighborhood. He didn't live here long. He just lived here for about 3 years. He was contracted to come in to work at some of the saloons that were here, or better known as the, some of the saloons kind of doubled in as saloons slash brothels. This becomes important because of the impact that it had on his life. Not that he had written anything major, but if you work in a candy store, then you might be tempted to take a piece of candy every now and then. So you can imagine, if you follow that logic, if you work in a brothel, you might be tempted. And unfortunately, one of the things that led to Scott Joplin's health, or impacted his health, was contracting syphilis. However, he wrote some really, really beautiful music that we still enjoy to this day. Ivory Perry worked in city housing as an inspector, and he noticed things that other people should have noticed, but they didn't quite catch on to it. He noticed that the kids' behavior was being impacted by the lead paint that he saw children ingesting. For whatever reason, that became attractive. Apparently, I couldn't tell you through personal experience, but apparently it's sweeter or something. You had people that, children that were ending up chewing on the paint, and it was impacting their health, in particular their cognitive abilities. And he puts this together. He's not a physician, and he notices this and gets the attention of others who can do something about it. So after which, today your home has to be lead abated to prevent those cognitive disabilities that result from having ingested lead paint. He did get help from the alderman in 1970, so you can imagine for many people in the room, most of us, we were alive at that time before this became law. It forced landlords, and then because of this, in St. Louis, this took on a national profile where everybody became aware and everybody now has to try to rid their homes of lead. We talked a little bit about Shelley versus Kramer when I was talking about Herman Dreher. Herman Dreher working on this particular case with George L. Vaughan and Mary Bush Wilson. The house, when you see it, I'm thinking, it doesn't really seem like this would have been a big deal. But it was a very big deal. After they purchased the house and they discovered that the owners are black, then there's this big fight to get them removed. In front of the house is now a sign. It's different than the one that you see there. I used to think that that one was more like a tombstone. However, now the sign is a little bit more freestanding. But on the 4600 Labadee, once Vaughan had won the case for Shelley, the neighborhood almost overnight was transformed. The white residents moved out, and it remains a black neighborhood to this day. Augustus Tolton was somebody who did not want to accept the word no. He is from Missouri, but he is known to be the nation's first black Catholic priest. Despite wanting to be a priest, he is told over and over again, nobody will accept him as a novice. And so he decides that if I can't be made a priest here, I will go where they will make me a priest. So he goes to Rome, and he's ordained there. But he's from Missouri. Dr. Shropshire started off as a principal, and he is famous because he's known because when there was a crisis of educating black students in that part of Missouri, what he did, rather than enabled the loose kind of hit and miss areas where people were in different locations, he kind of centralized the education for black people in the region so that you could go to school from elementary and through high school. It was a very creative and labor-intensive effort that took place to be able to make sure that, as it says, seven counties could all get the best education they could offer for its time. Albert King was the first blues guitarist to be able to play with the symphony orchestra. And that symphony orchestra was the St. Louis Symphony here in town. You see a number of people who it's become more fashionable now to be able to play with symphonies. In fact, I remember the Seattle Symphony a few years ago doing Baby Got Back, of all things, with Sir Mix-a-Lot. So, you see people have becoming, symphony orchestra has become more daring and bringing more people in by bringing more artists in from different genres so that they can appreciate, not only the classics, but the new classics in the making. Poet Langston Hughes is probably the best known poet of the Black Renaissance, the Harlem Renaissance. born in Missouri. I think one of his, he has a number of really, really deep and impactful poems, such as I Too Sing America, or Aunt Sue's Stories, which is a favorite of mine, or Mother to Son, all of which reflect not only the lives of the people that he was around, but about the state of the country. When he talks about in I Too Sing America about being the darker brother who has been set to the side, but will one day come out, and those that set him aside will be ashamed. It's wonderful works, wonderful poetry that's spoken, and he died in 1960 in Harlem, where that was his base, but he was from Missouri. Now, Lou Brock was a star for the Cardinals when the Cardinals weren't always the most accepting of integrated baseball. In fact, I remember hearing from the friends of one of my good friends, his mother refused to go to Cardinal games because she remembered when there were people that would throw black cats onto the field when there were black players that were playing in the 50s. She never really got past that. But one of the ways that people grew to accept black players was to watch black excellence. And Lou Brock is an icon who was known for his base stealing skills. Arthur Ashe came to St. Louis because Richard Hudlin was in St. Louis. Arthur Ashe was known to be great, but he could be greater if he had the right coach. And that coach was Richard Hudlin, who was teaching at Sumner High School. So he came to Sumner from Virginia, and he lived and played where Arthur Ashe was developed into the first black winner of Wimbledon after being trained under Richard Hudlin here in St. Louis some 15 years later. Of course, he went on to become a college sensation at UCLA, but to get him to UCLA, he first came to St. Louis to go to Sumner High. I'm looking, and I know that I have gone well beyond my time for conversation, for questions. I'm gonna stop here, but that's why it says thank you, but I'm open for any questions that you have, and I'm gonna do my best to answer them. So if you can let me know.
Please. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Wright. Everyone give Dr. Wright a round of applause. Thank you for blessing us with your presence. My name is Vinetta Morrow. I'm African American History Initiative Community Programming Specialist here at the Missouri Historical Society. Thank you so much for joining us this morning. This program is part of the Tuesday Daytime Series here at the museum. We do about 6 per quarter. Before we adjourn to go up to the museum shop for Dr. Wright Jr.'s book signing for the second edition of Extraordinary Black Missourians, we do have time for questions and answers. So when you came in, either Charles or Cecily, thank you so much, handed you an evaluation, which is very important. Please fill those out. There is a QR code on the back, so hopefully you got a pencil if you can grab that with your phone and fill that out. You were also given an index card.
And so that index card is for you to write your questions on for Dr. Wright Jr. So if you'll take the time to do that right now, we'll have some folks come around. Lindsay and Cecily can grab those for you. So put your question on there on the index card, raise your hand. If you weren't given one, we do have some extras as well. So raise your hand if you didn't get one, and one will be given to you. So we'll take a few minutes for that. I do want to make some announcements. Every Thursday night, in addition to the Tuesday daytime program series, we do Thursday nights at the museum every Thursday night, not just the Twilight Thursday concerts on the North Lawn. So please connect with us through all the major channels of social media. If you go to mohistory.org/subscribe, you can subscribe to the email list as well. We do have programs on Saturdays and on Sundays. I'd like to thank the production team in the booth for always making sure everything is smooth. The community engagement team that I am a part of, resource protection, housekeeping, our marketing and communications department. If you have not been to the library and research center at 225 Skinker, please visit. They are reopened. They were closed for some months for remodeling. You can also access mohistory.com. And please, 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 downtown Soldiers Memorial, the Vietnam exhibit is up. It is absolutely gorgeous. It is thought-provoking. You will laugh. You will cry. There's truth-telling. There's joy. And there is space. They have programs as well. So any questions ready? Do we have any questions ready? If Charles or Cecily or Lindsay could bring those up. Okay, I'll come and grab those as well. We also have some of our friends and community collaborators here from Missouri State Parks and also from the Scott Joplin House Historic Site. Victoria and Cookie are here. We have some groups to come in. Thank you so much. Any facilitators of those groups who are visiting us today, make sure that I have your information so that we can connect as well. Thank you so much. Dr. John Wright, we're ready for the question and answer session. Thank you.
I've got three questions. Was James Beckwourth an orphan? No, he was not. He was born on a plantation in, I believe, Kentucky, and he then moved to St. Louis, became a blacksmith, but he was not an orphan. Why was he poisoned? It was a tribal dispute over who would run that particular tribe. And to get him out of the way is why he was poisoned. And what was Elizabeth Keckley's memoir called? That's a good question. I do not recall the name of the book. I know that it exists. I know that the Lincolns were upset at what she wrote. She did not intend for it to be an intimate tell-all, but just an inside view, an insider's view of the White House while she was there, and it did not go over well with the Lincolns. I do not know the name of the book. That gives me some homework. Thank you.